And the opportunity given to me, I am grateful to the department and the organizers for this opportunity. So I will be talking about the endoscopic endonasal approach to cella, basic approach. So in this, as Professor Agarwal sir has said, that it is very important to know the anatomy. This is the basic of endoscopic surgery or any microsurgery. So you need to know detailed, study the CT and MRI in detail, and you should know the anatomy very well before you proceed. So study the sphenoid sinus, especially the septa, going laterally onto the carotid or onto the optic nerve, cellar floor, paranasal sinuses, any septal deviation, because that also can obstruct in your surgery. Tuberculum cell, clinoid recess, position of the carotid artery. If the space between two carotid arteries is very small, then it is difficult. Where is the optic pathway and where is the normal pituitary? Although at times it is not possible to know when the tumor is very big, but still during surgery you can find out the normal pituitary gland, and usually it is at the corner, either at the top or to the side or posteriorly. Now as Professor Deepak has said, that it is very important to know beforehand. Even during surgery you can know the dehiscence wall, but if you know beforehand that there may be dehiscent wall, there may not be any bone over the carotid. And the worst part is sometimes the septa is going and attaching to the carotid artery or optic nerve, which does not have any bony, this thing. Or at times even if there is some bone, it is usually very thin. And if you just try to avulge it, take out the septa by any forceps or anything, you just injure the carotid artery or the optic nerve, the patient becomes blind. So here you find that there may be a combination of both, that septa is going on to the carotid artery, and at times this bone is, although it is thin bone, at times even this thin bone is also absent. So avulging the septa here may give rise to carotid artery injury, which may result in disaster. And here you can find that the optic nerve, see the optic nerve on both sides is not having any bone. So dehiscent optic nerve, and if you use, by chance you should never use monopolar cautery in the sphenoid sinus. If you use it, then you can injure this, and also at times the septa is also going and attaching to the optic nerve. So that can also create a problem. And again, as Professor Deepak has said, that you may have a O-node cell and the optic nerve may be dehiscent. Any bony wall may not be there. So if you find double floor, you go inside the cella and you find that there is a horizontal something going on. It is O-node cell is nothing but is the posterior ethmoid cell, which is in close relation to the optic nerve, because it is superior and posteriorly. Usually it doesn't cover the carotid. So here you should be very careful. Double flooring means there may be O-node cell. Then the other anatomy is especially important in the CSF leak, is that this is the cribriform plate, this is the middle turbinate. So medial to the cribriform, the middle turbinate is the cribriform plate. So you can have a leak from cribriform plate, that means it is medial to the middle turbinate. So go, only you have to work medial to the middle turbinate, nothing to do with the posterior, means any ethmoid cells need not to be disturbed. But if the defect is there either in the lateral lamina, see this one is the lateral lamina and this is the fovea ethmoidalis. So various places you can have CSFLE, find out which structure is involved and act accordingly. So anatomy is very important. You can have septal deviation which can be find out in axial cut or coronal CT scan. Then in pituitary tumor, you should know where is the position of the carotid artery, where is the normal pituitary, where is the chiasm. So all these things you should identify, the optic chiasm here. The usually the normal pituitary is draped around the tumor. So it is either superior to the left or right or posterior. So beforehand, if you diagnose it, this is good. And the carotid obviously is the flow wide scene, and the distance between each carotid is important. See here, there are two carotid very close to each other. You can call it something like kissing carotid. This is normal position, assistant here, surgeon, even the staff nurse can be here or on to the opposite side. But your screen should be ahead of you so that you can watch them without any distortion of your neck, and the anesthesiologist on the foot side. So patient should be placed in such a way that you can watch both the nostrils. And the other mistake which is commonly done is that you place the hand, you are standing on the right side and your assistant has placed the head far away from you on the left side. So you have to lean forward to do surgery, which is not good. And then if you have supracellular or anterior cranial fossa lesion more anteriorly, then you have to go for neck extension. If it is posterior fossa, then neck flexion. This I think I'll cover when I do the surgery. Stabilize your scope, this is important. And in stabilizing your scope, you should use the nasal vestibule correctly. So don't just hang it in the middle of the nasal cavity. You stabilize your scope and push it superiorly so that it gets stabilized, number one, and number two, it widens your nasal cavity. And two instruments which you use, one to the left and another to the right, also widens the space available in the uninostril, although later on you should make it binostril approach. Head and elevation, then identify the anatomy very well. This is the coina, middle turbinate. The tail of the middle turbinate leads you to the coina. Inferior turbinate, middle turbinate, septa, the floor, then coina, Eustachian tube opening. The tail of the middle turbinate, if you follow it inferiorly, it will lead you to the coina. The first structure after you medialize the middle turbinate will be the uncinate process. And inferiorly, if you remove this portion, you will find the maxillary sinus opening, which is at the superior portion. So this becomes the inferior most boundary of your work, especially if you are doing pituitary surgery or CSF leak. So middle turbinate again, you should identify the ostium, which is usually about 1 to 1.5 centimeter superior to the coina. So 1 to 1.5 centimeter superior, you will find this, but at times it is not seen, the mucosa is covering it. So as Professor Agarwal has said, that if you anywhere between the coina to this about 1 centimeter, if you don't find anything, you just gently push it, you will be there in the sphenoid sinus. But don't go too much higher. If you go more than 1.5 centimeter, then you might enter the anterior cranial fossa. So this is the Haddad flap. I think I'll show you rather than discussing it, to one superior cut, one inferior cut, you can extend it more inferiorly if the defect is large. You can come in the floor of the nasal cavity and make a large flap. So there is a rescue flap also. In rescue flap, there is only one cut, whereas in traditional flap, you make superior cut and then inferior cut. The superior cut, as Professor Agarwal said, that don't go up to the highest because these are the olfactions. So 1 centimeter below you should make a cut, and if you need to go here, supposing in the anterior cranial fossa, make a cut here, take out all the bone there, perpendicular plate, and reflect that. That so even if there is an anterior cranial fossa lesion, you can save olfaction. Rescue flap. So you can go for middle turbinectomy of one side, especially it is not required if you have a simple pituitary, but if it is a giant pituitary or there is an extension higher up or extended approach, then it is better to remove the middle turbinate because otherwise this will be obstructing the instrument play. Posterior ethmoidectomy should always be done on one side or other side because otherwise you will not be able to see it. So always dissect inferior to the ostium, identify it and then go inferiorly. See here, if you see it well, in the sphenoid sinus, if you don't remove the posterior ethmoid, so this is posterior ethmoid, then it will be very difficult to visualize the anterior part and especially the lateral part. If there is a CSF leak here in the anterior and lateral portion, unless you remove the posterior ethmoid, you will not be able to see it. And removal of the posterior ethmoid helps you to station your scope. So you can station your scope here and use two instruments to work here. So posterior ethmoidectomy is a good this thing, even in the pituitary surgery. So this is very important, and most of the time you can see the optic protuberance on both sides, and if you extend these optic protuberance, anything in the middle will be the tuberculum cellae, the planum sphenoid, lateral OCR, medial OCR. So this is very dangerous space, medial OCR. If you use Carrison punch here, at times your carotid artery comes medially and make a hook there. And so I have injured carotid once, done a mistake. So this is the portion where especially you should always use a drill. Again, anatomy. This lateral OCR is anterior clinoid process in the from superior side. Medial OCR is the middle clinoid process, and the clival recess, carotid protuberance, the cella. So this is after the removal of, this is what is required, the four blues, superior intracavernous sinus, laterally the cavernous sinus, and the posterior intracavernous sinus, clival recess. You should remove nicely the anterior face of the sphenoid. If you remove only little bit of anterior wall of the sphenoid, then your instrument manipulation will be difficult. So usually 2 suction width is required below this. Otherwise, just seeing the clival recess will not work. You will not be able to manipulate your instrument. So remove extensively the anterior face of the sphenoid, and then you can see everything very nicely. And there is nothing, I mean, no important structure or dangerous structure. So don't get scared by removing the anterior wall of the sphenoid. It is very important part of your pituitary surgery. But here you should be careful, medial optic carotid. This is carotid protuberance, this is optic protuberance. Here you should be careful, don't use Carrison punch. You use diamond drill and then make it excel and take it out by micro dissector. People say that they don't cauterize the dura, but I found that it bleeds sometime in big tumor or even in a small tumor because there are vessels in between the two layers. There are people who say that you go for extra capsular dissection. In that case, the dura should not be coagulated. But I always go for intracapsular first, decompress it, and then go around and take it out. And if there are multiple pouches, this is very important. If you see the arachnoid descent is not uniform, that means some residual tumor is left. If there is dead space anterior to the chiasma, you can fill very well with the fat. But if it is posterior to the chiasma and the ventricle has been opened, don't put in especially the small fat. Otherwise, it will float in the ventricle and block the aqueduct of Sylvius. You can use it, the other technique, like use facial atta and then put in fat on it so that it does not migrate. Multilayer technique using facial atta, fat, and even the cartilage can be used. You can obliterate to reduce chances of CSF leak, obliterative technique. Fibrin glue should never ever be placed in between the layer. So many people, they use fat, facial atta, and then so between each layer they put in fibrin glue. It is wrong. Putting in fibrin glue between the layer will prevent fibrosis. So the leak will start. At the most, if you are not very confident, just put in some fibrin glue at the margins, but don't put in a layer of fibrin between the two layers. Multi-layer closure, and a word about the planum sphenoid. See, if you have a very large pituitary tumor and you don't remove the tuberculum cellae or the planum, then it is almost impossible to take out this tumor. See, going from a nasal cavity, you will not be able to reach here. But if you remove bone, then you can push the dura. There is no need to take out the dura from here. Just take the bone out and push the dura up, you will reach this. Otherwise, part of the tumor in the supraocellular region will be left behind, especially if it is fibrosis. So limitation is if relative sinusitis, absence of pneumatization, very close carotid artery, lateral extension, lateral to the artery or the nerve, because with some experience, lateral to the artery you can go, but lateral to the nerve you should try to avoid, because in that case, if you manipulate the optic nerve, then the vision will go. Any brain invasion or edema is a relative contraindication. If you have a cap, then it is good. If the tumor consistency is firm, relatively, you should avoid, especially in the beginning, involvement of the vessel all around or encasement of the optic nerve, especially if it is going lateral to the optic nerve, one should not. Very large supracellular extension or retro is a relative contraindication. Once you have a sufficient experience, then it can be done. Down sloping of the planum. At times the planum is sloping down, so it is obstructing your manipulation. In that case, in the beginning of your learning curve, avoid it, or otherwise you have to drill the planum. Steep learning curve is another limitation. Around 50 open microscopic endoscopic technique, I think, is required to master this technique. So, thank you very much.